Hello and welcome to the inaugural Heart of America Athletic Conference Women's Golf Media Day. I'm your host, Emery Songer, on-air host and producer at iHeartRadio in Des Moines, Iowa. And today we're joined by Mount Mercy University interim head women's golf coach Chris Shank and Kirsten Miller. Coach Kirsten, how are you guys today?
Great. How are you?
Thank you.
I'm great. It's getting closer to spring, getting closer to real golf weather. Kirsten, you're from Perth, Scotland.
Yes.
A lot of golf history in your home country. I mean, many consider it the home of golf. So how'd you get into this game and how did you make it all the way to Mount Mercy?
So originally my dad had taken me out to just play about on the driving range back home. And then we got into some lessons back there as well. I think I was about 9 years old, maybe. So I was what you would probably consider late to the game, but from there it's just been nonstop every year out practicing countless hours, honestly, just trying to get as far as possible. So then I found Mount Mercy and decided it was a good fit for collegiate golf.
So did you know where Mount Mercy was?
Honestly, no. I had spoken with the coach at the time and she told me around about where it was. So I looked up at the area and saw that it was roughly similar to where I am back home. So not too far into town, but not too far out of town either. So the weather is just a bit different. It's still cold, but I'm not used to as much snow.
Yeah, it's a little hard to get out when it's snowy outside. Do you play any of those great historic courses that you guys have in Scotland?
I've played quite a few, yeah. And this summer, I've just secured a job caddying at St. Andrews.
Oh, man.
So, yeah, that'll be impressive.
Yeah, that sounds like the dream, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
So, Coach, you took over the program in January as the interim head coach. What's that experience been like so far for you?
Yeah, it's been great. I've had a great experience since moving to Iowa from Colorado in August, just trying to, you know, do my best to build a championship culture and change the expectations here to that being of, you know, winning conference championships and attending nationals every year. It's been a hefty task. It's hard to get people to come to golf in Iowa. But I think having the program and the facility that we have and the girls and their passion for the game and getting better is really, easy to help me recruit, you know, go through that process.
So, I mean, you're no stranger to the program. You're an assistant coach in the fall, so you're familiar with the players that you have. How did that fall season go from your perspective and what would be your assessment of the team after that?
Yeah, I think the largest, I thought we had a great fall season, especially right off the bat. We were in Dyke and we, you know, broke a school record for low 36 holes. So that's great. We probably didn't finish as well as we wanted to at conference preview, that being, you know, sideways rain and, you know, 30 degree temperatures. But I have really high expectations for the spring and the girls are probably finally acclimated a little bit better, most of them being international. So they're kind of settled in and ready to play some good golf.
Well, you alluded to that diversity. Obviously, you have Scotland, England, Japan, Spain. What's it like trying to coach so many different cultures and personalities as they kind of acclimate to Mount Mercy and what you guys are expecting of them?
Yeah, that's a very large hurdle, especially having, like you mentioned, different cultures and everybody has kind of different expectations for themselves and especially how they handle, ups and downs. They all handle it a lot differently. And that being said, we are introducing two more in the fall of 23. We'll have a girl from Malaysia and one from South Africa. So I think our freshmen, that are American, they've done a really good job kind of welcoming those international students in and taking care of them and putting them under their wing and showing them the ropes. And it's made that transition a lot easier for them. But it is a little difficult coaching someone who's, you know, probably a little bit more emotional or less emotional and hard to read. It goes both ways. So.
Just on that, you know, front, while we're on that topic of a conversation, how's that recruiting, you know, trying to find, you know, those diamonds in the rough, if you will, around the entire world and kind of what tools do you use to try to find the right players to add to the program from so many different places?
Yeah, I think first impressions are probably the biggest tool that I try to use. If I'm going to set up a call with, you know, a golfer, that first impression and them telling me about themselves is probably the biggest thing that I take away from our interactions. But, you know, looking at scores and seeing what different types of courses that players are playing and seeing, you know, how they're improving and if they're improving. And then when I get that chance to have a one-on-one with them, you know, kind of seeing what their game is about and how they handle certain situations. I know Scotland, being from Scotland, Kirsten has, you know, she played the best at our conference preview, probably because the weather was so cold and she's the one that's more used to that. So finding those players that have, you know, different strengths and different weaknesses really helps us have a rounded out team. So really just trying to recruit people that are, you know, as Tiger says, finding it in the dirt and going to put in the work and have the effort.
How do you sell them on Mount Mercy?
I sell them on the fact that we have amazing facilities and we are going to win conference championships and eventually national championships very soon. And that's the expectation. And I want the girls that want to be a part of that and are going to put in the work to be successful.
All right, Kirsten. So let's talk about that fall season for you. How did it go from your vantage point and what was your assessment of how you performed in the fall?
Yeah, right off the bat, we set a school record, which was really impressive. I personally didn't expect to do so well just coming into the first tournament. It was a big adjustment, but I've gotten to play so many different courses and meet so many different people, which really helps with the whole transition into collegiate golf. I think my performance-wise, I could have performed slightly better, but again, just with it being first semester, getting acclimatized to being away from home basically, and then balancing school and golf and being away so much competing. So overall, I think it was a pretty successful first season for myself, and really just building from that, hoping to do better this season as well.
Well, you're about to travel to a little bit of friendlier golf climate this time of the year in Texas for a tournament next week. So how much are you guys looking forward to actually getting to play in some warm weather, and how do you expect you guys will perform down there?
I think as a whole, the whole team's looking forward to getting outside, actually seeing the ball fly again. That'll be really nice. I think we're all looking forward to some nice weather as well. So hopefully that'll bring some really good scores. I know over the winter, we've all been putting in as much work as we possibly can. So we've been making use of our facilities here, like our new golf room with simulators, all that as well. So hopefully get some good scores, get a team win potentially as well. So, yeah.
Coach, what's your expectation of your team when you go down there?
Like Kirsten mentioned, you know, they've been putting in the work. We have a bunch of different simulators and launch monitors here. So everyone's pretty much dialing themselves in this last week. And, you know, if we can get down to Texas and, you know, get used to having some short game and some green reading skills that we haven't been able to practice in a while, I expect us to play very, very well. I know that they've been hitting the ball well, just on the launch monitors. And, you know, we went over a ton of different tactics and, you know, dispersion drills and course mapping. So I expect us to have a win when we leave Texas.
So you have so many different types of players and so many different cultures represented. How do you kind of make sure that you're hitting the right buttons with these players, knowing that not only do you have, you know, eclectic group of people from different parts of the world, but also trying to learn about their golf game, since you probably didn't get a chance to see them in person a whole lot before they got to campus?
Yeah, that's that is learning on the spot. That is, you know, asking, you know, just asking that question, like, hey, do you want me around to help out for a couple holes, or do you just want to be left alone? Like, what kind of help or assistance or advice do you need? What helps? What doesn't? What do you prefer? Just finding that out about all the players, and then being there when I need to be there. Do they need help with yardages? Do they just not want to see a coach the entire day? Do they want to see a coach every 2-3 holes? Just having that open conversation, it really makes it a lot easier than me trying to figure it out and remember it.
Kirsten, what about you on the player side of things? Such an interesting group of players. What's that been like for you? And has there been an adjustment for you guys as you kind of learn about each other and what each other have been used to before you got to Mount Mercy?
I think we've all gelled really well as a team. So the Americans on the team, they've all really been great at taking us and helping us with anything adjustment wise coming in. I know, like, being an international student for anyone's a difficult thing to do, just that adjustment being away from home. But being an athlete on top of that and not really knowing the culture is difficult. But everyone here has been a great support net, players, coaches, professors as well. So I think as a team, we all get along really well. And if someone's having a day where they're maybe missing home or something, everyone's there to help them. There's not one person that wouldn't want to offer a helping hand. So we're all really much a great close knit. I would class them as family now.
That obviously is music to coaches' ears, I'm sure. But when you talk about just the actual play coach, I think a lot of people that haven't paid attention to women's golf or paid attention to collegiate golf in general would be very surprised that a Midwestern conference like the Heart is so deep and competitive like it is in women's golf. How would you describe to somebody who probably hasn't followed a lot of women's golf at how difficult it is to be one of the top teams in this conference?
Yeah, there's, you see that at every event that we go to. There's just, every team has, you know, players that they expect to be at the top of the leaderboard. I don't know if NAIA in general just gets a lesser, you know, rep because they're always at the bottom of the list. If you see D1, 2, 3, and then NAIA, but you know, I would gladly put, you know, some of my best players up against some of the best D1 players. There's the conference itself is just going to get better, you know, especially as we're recruiting more and we're getting a ton of good talent into the conference. It's only going to get harder. But if you're not following women's golf in general, you should be, because they're the most passionate and the most dedicated players, I would say. So even more so than men, and even into the professional realm, you'll see that, you know, they're harder workers than most guys are going to be. It's just a lot more fun to be around and to watch and to follow.
Mount Mercy University interim head women's golf coach, Chris Shank, Kirsten Miller. Thanks so much, guys. Good luck this season.
Hey, thank you very much.